cries out to the Lord. The psalmist realizes that the way up and out is prayer rather than despair. When life gets hard, remember prayer, not despair. Come on, somebody. When things get difficult, remember prayer. And you've got to be able to get to a place where you are willing to cry loud and spare not. Cry out to God to hear your earnest prayer. Ah, we've cried out to everybody, but you've got to cry out to God. And God already knows just what every tear means. He knows what every hiccup stands for. He knows what every sweat relates to. Cry out to the Lord. Dr. Garden Taylor, who was pastor of Concord Baptist Church of Christ in Brooklyn, New York for 42 years, often spoke of his days as a young preacher in Louisiana during the Depression. Electricity was just coming into that part of the country, and he was out in a rural black church that had just one little light bulb hanging down from the ceiling to light up the whole sanctuary. He was preaching away, and in the middle of the sermon, all of a sudden the electricity went out. The building went pitch black. And Dr. Taylor didn't know what to say, being a young preacher. He stumbled around until one of the elderly deacons sitting in the back of the church cried out, "Preach on, preacher! We still can see Jesus in the dark." Sometimes that's the only time we can see Jesus, is when we are in the dark. Oh, come on, somebody. Sometimes that's been my best prayers. That's been my best sermons, when I was preaching my way while I was in the dark. Sometimes that's our best praise. That's our best shout, while we're dancing in the dark. I don't need no light. I don't need no organ. I just need to hear the voice of God. And sometimes while you're in the dark, that's the best place to be, because Jesus knows how to light up every dark situation. He knows how to come in and turn it all around. He can see us, and we can be confident that he hears our prayers. In Luke 18:1, Jesus said, "Men ought to always pray and not faint." Garden of Gethsemane, as Jesus anticipated drinking the bitter cup of sin and experiencing the dregs of God's wrath while upon the cross, what did he do? In the long night of his spiritual struggle, he prayed. What an example Jesus set for us. In hard times, we must pray and faint not. Step two, and I'm going to stop with step two. We have to hope in hard times. We have to expect God to be forgiving and not condemning. The psalmist continues, I'm in the text, y'all. I'm in the text. The psalmist continues in 3 and 4, "If thou, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand?" If God was of this disposition, stand before him. Who in this room, if that's the kind of God he were, could stand? Who That's why we're here. Because we can't. With man, it is. Y'all ain't there. But with God. Aren't you glad you're in the possibility number? Look, thank God that he deemed me possible through the blood, the shedding of the blood. So we confess, so the silence continued. He said, if thou, Lord, he said, who shall stand? He said, then he says, but there is forgiveness with you that thou mayest be feared. It is said, the early Christian theologian Augustine wrote the words of verse 4, but on the wall of the room where he lay dying, facing death, reading those words, there is forgiveness with God. They said that that's where he had at the top in his room. He said because that gave him comfort to know that he was soon going to meet God, who was gracious and forgiving. He's gracious and forgiving. God is gracious and forgiving. God is. Oh, you're going to need that one day. You're going to need to remind yourself one day. I know you all right today. I got you. But you're going to need to remind yourself one day that God is gracious. Yeah. I didn't understand that, Pastor. I did not understand that keep living peace. You know, keep living this, that, and the other. Now that I didn't, people used to say that, keep living. No, there was a time that I didn't understand keep living. There was a time I did not understand that cliche, keep living. But now that I am, you're still where I am and living, oh my God, I thank God for being God. I thank God for, I thank God for being who he is. We ought to thank God. I ain't gonna make it selfish. We ought to thank God for who he is. Y'all ain't got it yet. We ought to thank God for who he is. During Babylonian captivity, the children of Israel had plenty of time to reflect on what got them there. This is the ministry of hard times and suffering. Amen. But it forces us to get real. To get real with our shortcomings, to get real with sin, to get real, and to get real with God. You know, life will help you get real with God. Oh, no. Illnesses will help you get real with God. Thinking about your future will help you get real with God. Because if you think that your future is in the hands of man, you're scared. But thinking about your future, my God, you can get scared and get under in your bed, get under the cover, pull the blinds down, turn the lights off, get it dark, because thinking about future is scary. Some of y'all in the future and y'all scared. Y'all scared to live today because you're talking about what you won't have tomorrow. But I'm here to say that our hope must be in God. If God lets me, can I just preach it like I feel it? If God wakes us up this morning, God's going to make a way for us to get through the day. Amen. Give us this day my daily bread. And then if God lets you see yourself through another day, thank God that God, you saw me through another day, and then he wakes you up a new day. This is the day, a new day. It ain't yesterday's blessing. It ain't yesterday's mercy, but it's a brand new day, a brand new day to hope for another blessing, another hope for another breakthrough, another hope for you to protect me, another hope for you to keep me in my right mind. You've got to understand that every day that God blesses gathers us is a day of thanksgiving, and we must have hope that God will see us to the very end. So you got to expect. What are you expecting? What are you expecting from God? And when you expect something, expect it from God. That nobody can do it for you. To know to do good and not do it, that's a sin. If anyone knew this, it was David. Listen to him. David, that's why, David, listen to David. Listen to David in Psalms 32:1. He said, blessed, happy, believe, is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Then he continues in verse 5 to 6. He said, I acknowledge, this is David talking, I acknowledge my sin unto thee. I told y'all last week, confess your faults one to another. Confess your sin only. That's been tearing with me all week, because when you confess your sin to one another, people will hold you hostage. But the Bible says, confess your sin. He is faithful. He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And this is how he put it. You're right. He said, he will throw it into the sea of forgetfulness. That you, he don't remember. What? He doesn't go scuba diving. Amen. Help me preach this sermon. Scuba divers go looking down in the deep. They go deep looking for something. Come on, somebody. I know some of y'all think y'all are signed to the scuba diver ministry, but the devil is a liar. Because the deeper you go, the harder it's going to be for you to see, because you got to first see what you are working with yourself. And some people don't like to look at themselves, but they'll be first to look at somebody. But I'm here to tell somebody, as I get my own breakthrough, that I thank God that you can look through your eyes the more you want and whatever you want to see. But there's a God that looks beyond our faults and sees what? Oh, y'all didn't hear that. 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 And he doesn't assign individual people to go scuba diving to remember how deep and how dark your stuff is. David said, you ain't got to tell me. I'll tell it on myself. You ain't got to remind me. I'll remind myself. Then God said, who told you to remind yourself? Who told you? Who told you to remind yourself when you asked me and I did what you asked me to do? Shame on those who don't. And especially in the body of Christ. So perhaps this morning what we need to confess is our reluctance and refusal to hope in God. Because if you're going to hope in God, you've got something good coming your way. Your hope, oh my God. But I said I was only going to do two, but I got to do three. But we'll let the third be the last. But then you got to patiently wait. You've got to wait in hard times and good times, and you got to expect God to move in his own time. Now, I hope. See, hope makes us willing to wait. See, the psalmist in verse 5, he said, I wait for the Lord. My soul doth wait, and in his word do I hope. When God gives you his word, keep your hope in his word. One thing we can do as we wait on the Lord, we have to realize that this thing, if God gives us opportunity to wait, is in God's time. God's word. When you wait on the Lord, y'all, the Lord will show us mercy. When you wait on the Lord will listen, and the Lord will use prophets. My brother is our pastor. He stated, so you are biased somewhat. My comments were, no, I'm not biased. He's our pastor. And that's the way we look at him. Our pastor is an awesome teacher of the word. We don't look at what he drives, where he lives, nor his personal life. We are a shepherd delivering God's word. We see a shepherd delivering God's word every day. So make a long story short again, people get involved in popularity versus power. So I ended our conversation with messenger versus the message. Don't judge the messenger, but listen to the message. Enjoy your warmth and blessed day. Lastly, thank you for being an awesome messenger and delivering a great message. I want you to come and find the nearest hour right now and give your life to the Lord. Amen. By accepting Jesus as your personal Savior. If you hear my brother or my sister, and you say, Pastor, I'm out of the ark of safety. I have not publicly accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. Come right now, my brother or my sister, as we are singing, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. If there's one, come. Come from wherever you are and give the Lord your life. If you're here, you say, Pastor, I am already a believer, but I would like to join this faith community. I want to give you hope in Jesus Christ. If you're here, come, my brother, my sister, the doors of the church are open for you. Is there your hope?
In God.
In God.
invites us to come. He said, whosoever will, let them come. And so today we don't come in remembrance, but we come thanking him for the sustaining power that's in the